Welcome all to yet another video, Dr. RS and you, on science of cosmetics and personal care products. Today we are in part 39, emulsifying agents. So we have completed part 32, 33 was a review again, and part 39. So now we are discussing physicochemical properties of emulsions. In part 38, we have discussed type of emulsions, and in part 39, in this video, we will be discussing about emulsifying agents. Physicochemical properties of emulsions, right? So 39 will be emulsifying agents, right? What is an emulsifying agent? See, again, emulsifying agent can be a surfactant, okay? They are all mostly surfactants, right? They are surfactants, and they are also called as emulgents. Emulgents, right? So now, how can you define emulsifying agent? Emulsifying agents reduce the interfacial tension between two phases, oil and aqueous. Oil and water, aqueous is water. And make one disperse in the other. So we have two phase. This is water, this is oil, there is an interfacial tension here. The surfactant reduces the interfacial tension and make one disperse into the other, right? Emulsifying agents stabilize emulsions by preventing, reducing coalescence of the dispersed globules. They possess certain type of affinity to polar and non-polar liquids that we will subsequently see. Classification of surfactants, we saw that, we will revise that again. Consequently, the emulsion is stabilized, right? So basically, the emulsifying agents reduce the interfacial tension between two immiscible liquids, that's oil and water, and in the process make one disperse in the other. There are a number of emulsifying agents which are available to form stable emulsions. But it is difficult to develop proper emulsifying agent for development of stable emulsions. Sometimes two or more emulsifying agents are required. Emulsifying agents are also called as emulgents. Okay, emulsifier, emulgents. So basically, emulsifying agents are used in combination. Right? We will come to that. So, for a more stable emulsion, emulsifiers are used in combination. 2-3 different emulsifiers are used. Why? We will come when we discuss hydrophilic lipophilic balance. So, basically here the emulsifying agent reduces the interfacial tension between two immiscible phases, oil and water, and make one disperse in the other. There's Bancroft's rule. What it says? If the surfactant is more soluble in water or the emulsifier, it forms oil in water emulsion. So oil soluble emulsifiers will aid in the formation of water in oil emulsion. This is the Bancroft rule. If the surfactant is soluble in water, or if the emulsifier is soluble in water, it forms oil in water emulsion. If the emulsifier is soluble in oil, it will aid water in oil emulsion. This is Bancroft's rule, right? There is yet another emulsifying agents by Griffin. Okay, Griffin devised an useful method for calculating balanced mixtures of emulsifying agents to provide a particular type of emulsion. It is called hydrophil lipophil balance. Hydrophilic lipophilic balance, you can say. It's called HLB method, which we will discuss in detail when we come to HLB. Every emulsifier has been given on an HLB scale, right? Now, in the Griffin scale, Griffin has given HLB only for a non-ionic emulsifier which ranges between 0 and 20, right? But now it is applied for anionic emulsion also, where it can reach up to 50, HLB can reach up to 50, most probably 40 is sodium lauryl sulfate, around 40, right? So originally Griffin developed these HLB scales for non-ionic emulsifiers, right? Which, and now it is applied to the other type of emulsifiers also, right? More about HLB we will discuss in the next session. HLB I want to introduce to you now, because HLB scale, lower HLB, if the emulsifier has lower HLB, it is more soluble in oil, it's lipophilic, right? If the emulsifier has higher HLB, it is more soluble in water. So if the HLB is 5, it's more soluble in oil. HLB 15, more soluble in water. So that is what Bancroft rule. Bancroft's, what it says, if the surfactant is more soluble in water, it forms oil in water emulsion. If the surfactant is more soluble in oil, it forms water in oil emulsion. The same thing, if the HLB is low, it is more soluble in oil, it is more lipophilic. If the HLB is high, it is more soluble in water, it is hydrophilic. Remember this. Let us, when the next chapter, we will discuss this. Now we will go to this we saw when we classified surfactants, no? Right? Emulsifiers, classification of emulsifiers. It's emulsifiers are also surfactants. Anionic, cationic, zutrionic or amphoteric, and non-ionic. When you see anionic and non-ionic, anionic and nanionic are widely used in emulsions as emulsifiers, right? Anionic and non-ionic are widely used in emulsifiers. A group of lecithin is also used, but not as a primary emulsifier. We will come to that, right? Now, anionic imparts negative charge, cationic positive charge. Here both the charges are there. And then non-ionic, it has no charge, it works on the hydration of the head group, but based on the conditions, it can develop charge also, right? So anionic and non-ionic is widely used, right? Further, we will see how the anionic and non-ionic emulsifiers are classified and examples in each, right? So anionic emulsifier, soaps. We saw that, right? Soaps are very good anionic emulsifier. Soaps are salts of higher fatty acids, right? Or fatty acids, right? So for example, sodium stearate. Stearic acid and sodium hydroxide, sodium stearate. Potassium stearate. Triethanolamine stearate. Okay. And calcium stearate. See, triethanolamine stearate, sodium stearate, potassium stearate, all these emulsifiers give oil in water emulsion. Calcium stearate usually gives water in oil emulsion. Right? So, these things have very high HLB, this is lower HLB. Water in oil emulsion, this is less soluble in water. These are all highly soluble in water. So, they give oil in water emulsion. Oil, water is the continuous phase here. Oil is the continuous phase here. Right? This is salt of carboxylic acid. This we, all the chemistry we discussed in the surfactants chapter, you can go through that also. But here, I have removed all the foaming agents and focusing only on the emulsifiers that is widely used. Lactylates are second group of emulsifier used. Example, sodium stearyl lactylate. Right? Sulfuric acid derivatives, alkyl sulfates. See, sodium lauryl sulfate is used as an emulsifier. Sodium cetostearyl sulfate. Sodium cetostearyl sulfate is also widely used as an anionic emulsifier. Right? Phosphoric acid derivative, potassium cetyl phosphate is used as an emulsifier. These are all high HLB. This is high HLB. This is high HLB. This is very high HLB. Sodium lauryl sulfate is one of the surfactant with highest HLB, 30 high HLB. Sodium stearyl lactylate, it's towards hydrophilic but not as high. Soaps are all, this is high HLB. Divalent soaps, low HLB. Right? So, these are all the anionic emulsifiers. It's a very narrow choice, right? Soaps are widely used. Soaps are widely used. They have their own limitations in an emulsion, but soaps are widely used emulsifiers in oil in water type of what oil in water type of emulsions, right? Now, there are lot of choices in the area of non-ionic emulsifiers. Okay? Non-ionic emulsifiers, we can categorize into three groups. Alcohols, esters and ethers. Okay? Alcohols have very low HLB. Okay? They can be only secondary emulsifiers. They can be secondary emulsifiers. Okay. Example, cetyl alcohol and stearyl alcohol. Lauryl alcohol, there are behenyl alcohol, there are many fatty alcohols. I have given example, cetyl and stearyl alcohol. So, by themselves, they are not a good emulsifier, but in a when in an oil in water emulsion, water is a continuous phase, and when Fatty alcohols are used with emulsifiers with high HLB. It works very well, right? When we come to theories of emulsion, we will see that it forms gel phase and gel networks, and it works. Fatty alcohols works very well in stabilizing the emulsion. That is why it is a secondary emulsifier. As such, it will not a good emulsifier, but in the presence of other emulsifiers, it works very well, especially in oil in water emulsions where water is the continuous phase, right? Then non-ionic emulsifiers, okay, glycerides, glycerin, derivatives of glycerin, glyceride, glyceryl monostearate, GMS, okay, glycerin is CH2OH, one group stearic acids, glyceryl monostearate, widely used emulsifier, right? It is a low HLB emulsifier. It is soluble in lipids, fats. It's not soluble in water, it is soluble in oil, but again with high HLB emulsifiers it will work very well. Ethoxylated glycerides, we have studied about vegetable oils. What are vegetable oils? Vegetable oils are triglycerides of fatty acids, right? We saw that. Triglycerides of fatty acids. When we studied the acid value, sap value and all, we said triglycerides of fatty acids are vegetable oil. Triglycerides means this is glycerin, CH2OCOR. So R is the fatty acid, stearic, palmitic, lauric. So when this is PEG6 olive oil, right, polyethylene glycol 6 olive oil, this derivative has high HLB. This is one of the emulsifiers in the market. So PEG6 olive oil, this is ethoxylated glycerides, right? Example, PEG6 olive oil, polyethylene glycol derivative, no? Then, so ethoxylated glycerides are made by reacting glycerides with ethylene oxide, right? Ethylene oxides, right? ETO, ethylene oxide, ethoxylated glycerides are made. Polyglyceryl esters. So it is polyglyceryl esters. Example, polyglyceryl 10 laurate. This is also high HLB. This is very good. This emulsifiers. Emulsifier is widely used. See, there is something, no? People don't want ethoxylated emulsifiers slowly because ethylene oxide is used, which is a petroleum based. So people are moving away from ethoxylated emulsifiers. They are very good non-ionic emulsifiers, ethoxylated emulsifiers. So but polyglyceryl 10 laurate is one such emulsifier which is not ethoxylated, which is used widely in green cosmetics. Polyglyceryl esters, right? Example, polyglyceryl 10 laurate is one example. Then sorbitan esters, we discussed this when we discussed the surfactants. It's basically spans and peens, right? Sorbitan monostearate, SMS. When we ethoxylate it, we get sorbitan monostearate or polyoxyethylene sorbitol monostearate. This is PEEN 60, this is PAN 60. This is when you ethoxylate it, high HLB. This is low HLB. So this is soluble in lipids, this is soluble in water. Your combination of high HLB, PAN and PEEN in an emulsion works very well. High HLB and low HLB. Same way, SMS, sorbitol monostearate, then sorbitol monolaurate or polyoxyethylene sorbitol monolaurate. This is PEEN 20. This is SPAN 20. Same way, sorbitol monooleate. This is SPAN 80. Polyoxyethylene sorbitol monooleate. This is PEEN 80. See, these are the sorbitol esters, right? These are the very widely used sorbitol esters, tweens and spans, right? Of course, spans are not ethoxylated, but low HLB, right? But when you ethoxylate spans, you get tweens, and that is IHLB, right? This is sorbitol esters. Then carbohydrate esters. This is also widely used in green cosmetics. Sucrose esters, widely used in green cosmetics, right? Ethoxylated carboxylic acid, ethylene glycol monostearate, 1 mole of ethylene glycol, right? It's used. So ethoxylated carboxylic acid, ethylene glycol monostearate, EGMS, is used as an emulsifier, and it's sometimes used in shampoos as an opacifying agent. That's okay. EGMS is also used in creams as emulsifying agent. People prefer GMS to EGMS, but EGMS-GMS combinations are also used in an emulsion, right? Then these are all the esters. Then ethers, non-ionic emulsifiers as ethers. Ethoxylated alcohols, very wide range. Okay, the degree of ethoxylation, no? It can range, no? 10, 12, 15, 20. So degree of ethoxylation. As the degree of ethoxylation increases, the HLB also increases. Right? So citrate and laureth. This is all the different degree of ethoxylation using cetyl alcohol, and this is with lauryl alcohol. Cetyl alcohol and lauryl alcohol. There are citrate 20, laureth 20, you know. There are same way lot of ethoxylates are available in this. Very good emulsifiers, a combination of the citrate, laureth ethoxylated alcohols or high HLB emulsifiers. Right, ethoxylated propoxylated polysiloxanes, right? It's a silicone derivative. So dimethicone copolyols belong to this group. Ethoxylated polypropylene oxide, PPG citrate 20. This is sometimes used as of now. People are avoiding ethoxylation. They are still in ethoxylated alcohols. No, they are moving away from this emulsifier. And the next widely used emulsifiers are alkyl glucosides. Citryl glucosides are widely used emulsifiers now. Right. So now citryl glucosides, it's alkyl glucoside or group which is widely used, right? Then citrate laureth, it's also widely used. Then GMS, very, very widely used. PEG6 olive oils and olive oil derivatives are coming up. This is also widely used. Sorbitan esters, widely used. Carbohydrate esters, slowly picking up. This is very, very important. EGMS is used. Right? So then, cetyl alcohol and stearyl alcohol, fatty alcohols are all secondary emulsifiers. In the anionic range, soaps are widely used, and sodium cetostearyl sulfate is also used. Potassium cetyl phosphate is also used widely as an emulsifier. Right? These are the emulsifiers in the anionic. Non-ionic, we have a very good choice. Methoxylated alcohols itself, there are so many emulsifiers available. Alkyl polyglucosides combination is available. Ethoxylated, propoxylated polysiloxanes also, we have a choice. Sorbitan esters, polyglyceryl esters, we have many choices. No? So, these are the non-ionic emulsifiers. So, cations are not generally used as emulsifiers. Cations are used in hair conditioners. If there are some hair conditioning product where cationic, it's cationic based, some emulsifiers are used, but cations are mostly used as an antibacterial agent in products like mouthwash and all those products, and it is used as a conditioner. Not widely, it's not used as a, generally it's not used as an emulsifier for creams and lotions. It's mostly anionics and non-ionics are widely used, and these are some of the major anionics and non-ionics that are used. And phospholipids in Zwitterion, phospholipids are generally used as in the drug delivery systems to make liposomes. To make liposomes. Okay. To deliver drugs through skin. Okay. And liposomes, it's the for drug delivery systems. Phospholipids alone, lecithin alone, is not used in creams and lotions because it has its own limitations. Lecithins can color the product. You can't get a perfect white product. But lecithin can be used at a very low level for its skin benefits, right? Skin benefits as a good moisturizer, lecithin, the lipids, no? So now, phospholipids as such is not used widely as an emulsifier, right? It can be used as an active in a skin product, but not as a sole emulsifier, right? This is the surfactant as emulsifiers, right? This is the classifications. You can, most of the surfactants in the market comes in this classification. Right. Now, there are some additives that act as a stabilizer and a rheology modifiers in an emulsion. Right. That forms, that can also form a rigid layer around the dispersed particle. Right. These are all the rheological additives as emulsion stabilizers. Right. This, we completely, all the things we discussed in the rheological additives. Rheological additives in building blocks, part 17, building blocks, rheology modifiers. We have discussed all the things which we are, I am going to tell you, have selected some for that are used in emulsions, right? And part 14 and 15, we have discussed all the surfactants. Surfactants are widely classified. You know, surfactants can be used as a solubilizer. Surfactants can be used as a foaming agents, foam stabilizers, foam boosters. But here, what I have shown you are surfactants or that are used as emulsifiers in creams and lotions. That specifically, those categories I have taken and have explained you. Now, rheological additives used in emulsions, especially when water is the continuous phase, there are some of the rheology modifiers that can stabilize the emulsion very well. These are plant-based cellulose gum and cellulose derivatives, right? Carboxymethyl cellulose, all those cellulose derivatives. Biotechnology-based sclerotium gum and xanthan gum, right? There are acacia and trichoganth are plant-based, used in pharma. It comes again and again in pharma, but in cosmeceuticals and cosmetic products, it's not widely used, acacia and trichoganth. It has been replaced by xanthan gum. We have various grades of xanthan gum that can be used in the emulsion. It forms a rigid barrier layer on the dispersed particle, and it can protect, and it rheologically modifies the continuous phase, especially water, and it stabilizes the emulsion. Same sclerotium gum is very stable gum, which can be used in emulsions, right, to stabilize the emulsions. Then these are all biotechnology based. This is plant based cellulose gums. Clay based bentonite is used. Hectorite is used, and magnesium aluminium silicate. This is very widely used. Magnesium aluminium silicate is widely used in emulsions. Right. This is very widely used. Xanthan gum is very widely used. And magnesium aluminium silicate is also very widely used. I have explained all these things when you go to the rheology modifiers, right? I have given what are the trade names available, magnesium aluminium silicate, and where it can be used, right? Same way, I have hectorite, bentonite, everything I have explained there, cellulosium gum, xanthan gum. So go to that section and see for further details. Synthetic, widely used acrylic acid polymers. Okay, there are various grades of acrylic acid polymers. They're also called carbomers, and it is widely used in emulsions, right? Widely used in emulsions when water is the continuous phase. All these agents are used when water is, which I showed as an example, is used when water is the continuous phase, right? It structures water and forms also rigid film on the dispersed particle, oil particle, and stabilize it, right? So this is what I want to explain you on the emulsifiers, right? More here, I want the emulsion stabilizers and the type of emulsifiers that are available and which can be effectively used to formulate emulsions, right? So this is what I would like to share with you in this part. So this is part 39. So emulsifiers. So in the next part, right, we will go into the depth of HLB. What is HLB and how HLB can be calculated? for an emulsion. No, for an emulsion, how we can optimize the HLB of based on the product, how we can use emulsifiers to give that HLB, right? It's one of the techniques to design the emulsifier levels for the product, right? It's a guide. So you can use it to select the use the emulsifiers, the ratio of the emulsifiers, right? Thank you very much for listening to this video, and till I connect you in the next video, bye to you all. Be happy, be safe.